Do you want to be a white tigress? What kind of a question is that? I'm Ryan Orok and I welcome you to this journey together. I'm happy that you're interested in the idea of becoming a white tigress and expressing yourself in the world as a white tigress and benefiting from the sexual practices of the white tigress to achieve more health, rejuvenation, and to lengthen your life. We're going to talk about all of that right now. And before I get started, this question is a bit of a misnomer because you don't have to actually choose to be a white tigress or not be a white tigress. You get to implement those practices which may be useful to you moving forward without necessarily becoming part of the lineage or having the entire practices as a part of your life every day. But Madam Lynn is going to talk to us about that later and I will get started then. So welcome. So what is a white tigress and who is She Lai? She Lai wrote a number of books in the white tigress tradition and the jade dragon tradition, which is the male-oriented other version of white tigressism. This is a very rare spiritual tradition. It's so rare, in fact, that I was studying sacred sexuality for over a decade before I even heard of it, really. And then when I began to study it, I was looking for people who taught it, and I could not find anyone who knew anything about it. So it's really difficult to find white tigresses and to learn about the tradition, with the exception of She Lai's books. So the focus of white tigress Taoism is to use sexual energy to maintain your youth, if you're already in it, to rejuvenate yourself, if you're already a bit older, and to become immortal, which has many different meanings, but it can mean anything from extending your life to achieving practical immortality, choosing when you're going to die. That's included in the book as well. We'll get there in a moment. So there was a White Tigress manual from Madam Lin, who She Lai studied with in Taiwan in the 90s. And that manual is a much longer, more comprehensive book of what we're going to be talking about today. The book is The Sexual Secrets of the White Tigress by She Lai. And he took the first 3 years of the training that you'd receive as a white tigress, and he compressed that and presented that within that first volume that we're going to be talking about, as these techniques of how to use sexual energy for rejuvenation, youthfulness, and to extend your life. So before we get started too deeply, I want to talk a tad bit about sexual and spiritual traditions, because we in the West understand things differently than people in the East do. In our Western Christian, Victorian, puritanical background that many of us have in the United States, less so in Europe, but it's also prevalent, we have this view of sexuality and spirituality. And in our world, sexuality and spirituality are almost not connected. You may have vows of celibacy, be told not to have sex, or be told with whom you're supposed to have sex, meaning just your partner, your spouse, actually, just your spouse once you're legally and lawfully married. I was a member of a religion where you weren't allowed to masturbate in this fundamentalist style. Some of these Christian religions don't let you dance or reveal parts of a woman's body, you know, all the way up to Islam restricts what a woman can show. And all of these other traditions have expressions about purity and chastity and doctrines and ideas about those that many of us are familiar with. However, it is not so in the East, at least not everywhere. However, in the East, they think about these things much differently. Although there are also very, let's say, repressive and rule-based and sometimes fanatical, even dictatorial rules around sexuality, especially women's sexuality in the East as well, there are a few tiny groups remaining that have passed down teachings around sexuality and spirituality that some call the left-hand path or the faster path to enlightenment and growth and development and expression, and even such things as immortality, not just enlightenment, but also immortality. And in the East, which has been, or in the West, which has been controlled by a violent religious tradition for a long time, the soldiers arrive and they wipe out the existing tribes and they bring the priests with them and they convert everyone and they take the books and they either burn them or take them to the Vatican and hide them away. And they kill everyone who knew the practices, all the shamans, all the medicine men, all that kind of thing. You had the Inquisition. It's possible that in the West, we did have traditions of spirituality and spirituality that involved sexuality for a long time, but we don't know really because these have been erased. Now, some people claim to still have some of these traditions. There's a fire medicine tradition of the Native Americans and perhaps Celtic traditions and other secret societies. If you read Dan Brown's books, he talks about some of these rituals and these secret sexual practices. It's possible that they existed very deeply underground. It's difficult to figure out fact from fiction, who did what. It's difficult to impossible, as far as I'm aware, to find teachers or people who are participating in Western spiritual mysticism. Of course, Aleister Crowley is a name who brought back some things from the East and began practicing them and trying to figure out how to do magic and manifestation through sexual energy. There's a few other names as well. The omnipotent is a name for people who are familiar with him. And some of the occult societies in, say, England or Germany or other places. Occult meaning hidden, by the way, not necessarily bad or evil or wrong, just hidden. But we don't really have connection to those societies. They aren't really running as groups. If they are, they can split off into different directions. We're not exactly sure what they teach. There's not a very clean lineage. A lineage exists in the East because what happens is you have a guru who passes something down to a student. And then once that student has mastered what the guru teaches, maybe puts a slight spin on it, but is pretty much what the guru speaks, they go to the next level and the next level. And so they can pass on knowledge in verbal ways or with notes over hundreds of years, sometimes thousands of years. I was just doing studies around Sanskrit, and they said that the verbal Vedic tradition is unbroken for thousands of years in some lineages because of the intense practices that they created to speak mantras and to precisely pass them on. So the East, when I say the East, I mean China, India, Japan. These places were, until recently, say 200 years ago, fairly untouched by the West. So they had continued their practices. And yes, there were invasions. There was Islam. There was Buddhism taking over in certain ways and spreading Confucianism. And she talks about that in the book. And these were at radical conflict at times with some of the things you're going to read about in White Tigress Taoism. Even modern Taoism today doesn't necessarily include or teach the things that you're going to read here. If you go study with Montauk Chia or someone else who's doing sexual Taoism, you're going to find different ideas and concepts taught than the ones you're going to find in the White Tigress manuals. And she talks about that in the book. She talks about how there isn't a club of people getting together studying, that a White Tigress is initiated by a single teacher, and she may know a couple students, but she might know no one. And then when she leaves her teacher, she actually leaves her teacher and does not return for further teachings or guidance or anything. And she may teach further, but there might be a line, there might be a string of teachers, but there aren't big groups. And that was necessary for several reasons. Number one, because of the repression, if they would find a group, they could kill and imprison everyone in the group and erase the lineage. And if they were not familiar with one another, if they couldn't give up one another, then they couldn't do that. So that was one reason why. So even with that little bit more openness in the East, it was still dangerous. It was risky to teach or disseminate or make claims about. As you can understand, if you could actually prove that you could create immortality, then where would that put you against all the other teachers who couldn't? Well, as you see, Catholicism and other Western religions, they don't like competition. And they don't like competition, especially that may be able to do things or know things that they don't know. So they tend to shut it down, murder those who and imprison those who do these things. And this is the same for Confucianism or Islam. And so for these reasons, this lineage has been very small for hundreds of years, and maybe going back maybe going back 1,000 years or more. We don't know exactly. We know Madame Lin, who I'll talk about later, introduce later, her lineage started in 1748. And she's been running it. She's received the same lineage that's come from that time. But it wasn't necessarily easy to find people to either teach you or to find students who were interested in this path. So this is a very esoteric, difficult path to find, even compared to Neo-Tantra or even Kashmiri Shaivism or something like that. There's even fewer documents, even fewer teachers. It's really a challenge. And it took me a few years after putting something out publicly on YouTube to find anyone who claimed to know anything about this practically. So that's one challenge. The other challenge is the practices. There's a 9-year complete cycle of learning to be a white tigress and to have full initiation. And as I'm looking into Eastern traditions more deeply, I see that there are initiations that take 3 years, 6 years, 9 years, even 12 years. So as long as a PhD or longer to have this transformational experience. Well, we in the West understand this kind of practice. Perhaps if you say, well, you're going to be a doctor and you're going to earn 6 figures or 7 figures, therefore it's worth it to spend, say, 6 years of your life, 8 years of your life, 12 years of your life becoming this thing that's going to give you great financial reward and great respect in society. But what we are less familiar with, especially today, is any sort of spiritual path that may take years and years to go through. And if we look at how pop self-help works, a lot of the courses and workshops, it's come to this workshop. If it's a weekend, it's $100, it's $400, it's $1,000, it's $5,000, it's $10,000. And we kind of have the idea that the more money I spend, the more transformation I have, the more spiritual growth I'm going to experience. And that isn't the view of the East at all. The view of the East is when you commit, then you have your transformation, then you have your growth, when you spend the years and years in practice. And so this is a completely different mindset, and we in the West are just figuring it out. But I have some good quotes for you so that you don't have to feel like, okay, if I want the value of this, I'm going to have to practice this intensely for years to have any results, because that's not the case. And the other thing that made it challenging, as I said before, is the claims. If we're claiming immortality, healing, rejuvenation, these are very intense claims. So again, this challenges the status quo. This challenges people who may not even believe what they hear when they hear it. And so it makes it challenging for people to get involved and to experience and to explore these paths. All right. So next step. This is a quote right from the beginning of the Secret Teachings of the White Tigress. And it's from the White Tigress manual that Shi Lai was using when he was talking to Madame Lin. So it was her book. And it says, if you cannot face directly into your sexuality, you will never discover your true spirituality. Your earthly spirit leads to discovering your heavenly spirit. Look at what created you to discover what will immortalize you. From the White Tigress manual. Again, sexual energy in the West, we have a lot of repressed shame, guilt, fear-based attitudes about it. We don't understand it as a power to be respected like fire and used for our good and our benefit and our transformation. If we just said fire's bad, don't do it, then we would not have most of society today, right? But that's kind of how we treat sexuality. They are suggesting something different in the White Tigress manual. Very quickly, who am I? My name is Ryan Orok. I've been a student of Eastern mysticism and sexual practices, especially in the sexual erotic arena, for over a decade. Some people will tell you that's impossible, that those don't exist, that it's not really that way. And I'm going to say that they are probably slightly infected with some of the Western ideas about sex and sexuality. I have a lot of my information from Osho and his students. I've been down this path in many ways, distant sexuality, orgasms without touch. There's so many things that are possible and we just don't know they exist. So I'm fascinated by all this. And when White Tigress-ism came along, it was right up my alley. I'm very fascinated by that as well. I want to dive in. I want to learn more. And so that's why we're talking today. I'm deeply studied in energy work, body work, mind work, trance work, hypnosis. I studied multiple forms of energetic and body work. I came out of a deep fundamentalist, I'm going to call it Christian tradition, so very repressed sexually, and it really didn't make me happy. So I started on this path, well over a decade ago, let's say that. And I continue to study these things. And as I said before, I've been approached by a white tigress in the summer of 2021. She said, I saw your interview and I don't want the teachings of white tigressism to die out. And the white tigresses I know, many have stopped practicing or they're hard to find. I can't contact them. And so how do I find out about, or how do I share about this? Because I'm living this path and I want to share it. And I interviewed her. And some of you have seen that interview, and that's why you're here today. And I appreciate it if you did and commented on that. But the interest has been growing, and I'm happy. Before we get started, let me recommend that you get the book. The book is excellent. It's not very expensive, and it's going to help you understand everything that we're going to talk about in our times together. As I said, this is the first presentation of what I hope is going to be many presentations about this topic, where we're going to dive into step by step each of the parts about it. In my interviews with the white tigress who spoke to me, I gathered some information. I have my own information, and then I hope to create an opportunity for us to share together. In fact, I want to have regular meetings to ask questions that I can take to her, that I can participate in, and just try to share this information. So this is what I said previously. It is not important that every woman become a white tigress. It is important that every woman be aware of her potential. Each female who reads this book and puts into practice just one restoration or spiritual exercise will preserve these teachings and honor the centuries of women who transmitted them. Quote from Madame Lin. Madame Lin being, of course, the teacher, the guru of this lineage that Shi Lai studied with in Taiwan. So again, you don't have to completely dive in and devote yourself to this forever. You can pick up parts, what you like, do that, leave the things you don't, and see what effect it has on your life. Okay, so when this book starts out, and I'm going to take several quotes from the beginning of the book and comment on them as we go through them. It starts with this idea. Sex is like a poison, and I'm quoting now. Sex is like a poison, and like most poisons, it is also its own antidote. Tigresses are not emotionally attached to sex. We simply see it as a very effective and powerful vehicle by which to restore and enhance our physical beauty and with which to delve into the sublime Tao to attain immortality. The white tigresses are Taoists who have discovered how to harness the most powerful energy of human experience, sexual energy, and apply it to the pursuit of health, youthfulness, longevity, and spiritual immortality. The white tiger's sexual practices and beliefs are but the means, not the end. Sexual energy is our springboard, propelling us to a more youthful and spiritual state of being. We see in our world the idea of sex being a poison. We see politicians going out of their way to make horrendous mistakes and embarrass themselves and shame themselves due to the fact that they're looking for sex and sexual pleasure. We see people leaving their families. We see affairs. We see ways that sex breaks up and destroys society all the time. We've heard of sex addiction and porn addiction. And we have all of these. And the interesting thing is all of these negative ways of sexual violence, they are influenced by some of the shame and the guilt and the fear that we are taught around sexuality. And while sex can be poisonous, in fact, they say that false use of sex is one of the reasons of aging and even death. They say tigresses are not emotionally attached. What does she mean? It means she's looking at sex as if it's an object, as if it's fire. How can I use this? As if it's a car. Where can this take me? As if it's a table. What can I set on this, right? We're not looking at it as, oh, it's sex. And if my partner would do this, then it would mean, ah, you know, and or if I did this, God wouldn't be pleased with me. That's not how they're viewing it. They're viewing sex as a tool. Now, is that the right way to view it or the wrong way to view it? I'm not going to comment on that. I'm just saying that if you're going to participate in White Tigress Taoism, it helps if you can let go of some of the guilt and the shame and the programming around sex and sexuality and begin to view sex and sexuality from the perspective of, okay, let's look at this tool. Let's look at these energies and see what we can do. She likens it later in the book to a boat that can take you over the river or over the lake to get you the place where you want to go without any attachment whatsoever. And as the second paragraph says, we're going to use sexual energy to push ourselves up, to jump, to propel ourselves. And we don't have any understanding in the Western world of using sexual energy for healing and transmutation and manifestation, but they definitely do in the East. And so that's what we're talking about here. Who is Shi Lai? Or what about Shi Lai? As I said, he's the author of the books. Apparently, he was teaching at some point. Everyone that I've contacted or has tried to contact him has not been able to get into contact with him. He was unable or unwilling to do an interview. He declined that. And as far as I know, no one studies with him at the moment. So if you know more, then let me know. But one reason that we're doing this right now is because Shi Lai is not. There are a few people in my Googling and searching in the last couple months who claim to be teaching or providing some sort of White Tigress teachings. I do not know how experienced any of them are. One of them was contacted recently. She said, well, I'm on maternity leave. Get in contact with me later. And someone else was contacted and we're still waiting to hear from. I do not know how much any of those teachers know, how much experience they have. So again, I want to provide a forum so we can begin moving forward and perhaps the people with more experience will show themselves. We will see. Nothing helps someone who knows something about something speak up more than watch someone talk about it less than competently or not as an expert. So, perhaps that will help. However, since we put up the video, I'm getting regular messages and contacted by people who say, hey, I want to learn this. I'm interested. Where can I learn more? And I kept saying, well, here's this White Tigress, my friend in Italy, who you can contact. And I don't know exactly where things go from there. But besides that, and you know, everyone has their lives and they're busy and they're doing things, I'm not sure where to learn. So that's why we're talking about this here now. So my purpose in doing this is to have a step between just reading the book as a theory and saying, okay, that was an interesting book. That sounds really fun. Maybe I'll try it someday. And the other side of it would be a full-blown initiation where you say, okay, now I'm going to found the teacher. She's my guru. I'm learning. I'm practicing. And again, even to find that may be difficult or impossible today. So I want to provide a couple steps to help us say, okay, found the book, I really like it. Now what? What are some steps we can take? And I'll continue to share them through this medium. The other thing that I want to do is to talk about sexual spirituality or spiritual sexuality, because a lot of us have very little connection to that in the West. And so let's dive into that a little bit. I will share a little bit about that and its connection to White Tigress Taoism as we move forward. Introduction. A white tigress is the name for a female. These are quotes from the book. Everything that I say up here is going to be quotes from the book unless I otherwise say. So just assume this comes straight out of the book. A white tigress is the name for a female who has undertaken disciplined sexual. We're going to add that to the dictionary. Okay. Sexual and spiritual practices for the purpose of restoring her beauty and youthfulness in order to realize her full feminine potential and the condition of an immortalist. Okay, clear enough. The term white tigress is applied to small, secret, and elite societies of female teachers. A male teacher is called a white tiger, who have inherited very ancient and unique sexual teachings developed and established long ago in China. The white tigress teachings continue into our present times, having adherents throughout Asia and Europe and now in America. The societies of white tigresses are not large, nor do they have structure other than their teachings and their methods. If you go a little bit deeper in the book, they will say what I said before, and that is these aren't big groups that are meeting and having expensive workshops in hotels in the Catskill Mountains. These are isolated teachers teaching a few students who are also perhaps teaching a few students, passing things down. And yeah, there's no structure per se. There's no LLC, there's no website really, although there are a few places to get more information that we can share, but there's no clearinghouse, there's no conversation place to discuss this. Now the definition of immortality. So if we're using sexual energy to become immortal, what does that mean? We have Western scientific methods for longevity and immortality. They're coming together now, or people are working on immortality. It's a big topic. Of course, we've always had makeup. We've always had plastic surgery for the visual, but now we're looking at stem cells. We're looking at all sorts of, we're looking at nutrients and microdosing and all sorts of systems for achieving further longevity and youthfulness. But there have always been these ancient Chinese secrets for rejuvenation. If you remember on TV when I was a kid, I used to watch Ancient Chinese Secret, and it was oil of Olay or something. I don't know. It was selling some product. So yes, the West takes everything and commercializes it and packages it and sells it. But they did really have ancient Chinese secrets, and that's what we're talking about today. So the definition of immortality from the book says, a wide divergence of meaning is given to the concept of immortality in many schools of Taoism. Some schools believe in actual physical immortality, wherein the body can be preserved as long as the person deems necessary. Another meaning is that the spirit and consciousness remain intact and lucid during death, and so would be able to direct the self to immortal paradises or heavenly realms of existence rather than its returning to this earthly realm. The most practical meaning is that the person lives beyond 100 years of age in good health, or as the Chinese say, retaining youthfulness within old age. To the tigress, however, immortality carries the ideas of living with optimal health, living longer while maintaining a youthful physical appearance and disposition, and achieving lucid consciousness upon death. We'll talk about what some of that means moving forward. So energy. If you are not familiar with Eastern concepts, let me take a moment to explain the energies discussed in the book. The West has no idea of energies or really states of consciousness. We are just beginning some researches in these paths, and you will find the idea that the body has energy poo-pooed. I always thought that Star Wars really resonated with people because it talked about the Force, this power that pervades the universe. And I think that was an attraction because our society doesn't otherwise talk about it, but I think a lot of people believe that something like that exists. Well, in the East, everyone understands that there's energy. They talk about chi, ki, prana, and maybe the modern people don't, but in all old times, they would say, okay, your body is not well, you have a chi blockage, and we need to unblock that, acupressure, acupuncture, these kind of things, right? And so we're dealing with chi, which is the body energy, the life energy, to transmute, transform, and perform everything that we're doing to get immortality, to get transformation as a white tigress. Okay, I'm going to read the quotes now. Energy, breath, and vital force are all interpretations of qi. In brief, it is the internal vital energy that is stimulated in acupuncture, and it is what the Asian considers the energy that animates all life forms. Sounds a little bit like the Force. The very warmth of the human body is a result of qi, which is thought to be like an inherent oxygen in the body, and blood that stimulates vitality and stamina. In Chinese thinking, the body can live for a certain period of time without food, breath, or blood circulation, which is true, but without qi, it cannot exist for even a moment. And Qing is another version of this qi energy. the very primal urge people have to reproduce themselves, the behavior we apply to expressing in sexual desire, the substances contained within the sexual fluids, the regenerative force are all qing and or sexual energy. Okay, so qi, general life energy, and qing, sexual energy, which is contained in the sexual fluids. Okay. Again, risks and dangers of the poison of sexuality. Sexual energy, if directed in a negative manner, can cause numerous ailments, from eating disorders to psychological traumas. Sex, no matter your preference, whether you desire it or abstain from it, is still the undercurrent of both your physical condition and your psychological temperament. Every human being has the choice to use it either positively or negatively. And growing up, I wasn't taught to do anything but just not to, and to only do it with this person at this time. So I didn't really get the choice to use it positively or negatively. That wasn't explained to me. The tigresses do it differently. Okay. This is the key to why white tigressism works and how it works. The orgasm is a person's most intense experience. No other experience is as totally focused or concentrated, providing not only a great sense of pleasure and relaxation, but also a powerful enhancement of all of one's senses. Of all the forces within humans, sexual energy is the strongest, and it is expressed in our daily life in countless ways, from consumption of food to sexual activity. The orgasm emits sexual energy from the body, not only in fluids, but also as a substantive psychological force. The tigress discovers how to absorb and make full use of the fluids and energies of her own orgasm and the male's orgasm to benefit her health and well-being. It is because sexual energy is the strongest force and influence on the human condition that the tigress chooses to make use of it to expedite her attainments of youthfulness and immortality. We in the West have yet to fully comprehend the intrinsic connection between sexuality and spirituality. To the Taoist, the sexual and spiritual refinement of qing, sexual energy, physical functions, qi, vital energy, breath, and shen, spirit consciousness, the three treasures, is the secret with which to unlock not only the restoration of our youthfulness, but our immortality as well. So that is how we get to the immortality or the rejuvenation, by harnessing the energy that's released during orgasm or sexual stimulation and receiving it and transmuting it into what we want. When you read this, you will understand that men and women within tigressism, as I'm going to call it on this slide, this is not your typical boyfriend, girlfriend, spouse situation. In fact, the tigress that I talked to, she said, I think it's impossible to have a boyfriend while you're doing these things. I'll get to other possibilities later, but if you're looking for, I want this person to fulfill me or to make me happy or have the traditional relationship, including perhaps children. And she remarked several times when I was interviewing her about the challenges of having children in this practice, which I think I could interview her at length about that again, because that's a deep topic. But this is different than that. This is different than what society normally teaches. So within tigressism, you can have focused spiritual practice. In other words, that you decide with another person to practice these things together, to share these energies, to achieve mutual growth and development, in which case you're called a jade dragon who works with your white tigress, or the white tigress is encouraged to get green dragons. And green dragons are men whose energy she harvests, so to speak, through orgasm multiple times in order to achieve what we're going to talk about on the next slide, which is the development of what they call the spiritual fetus. So the absorption of male sexual energy, which is also referred to as absorbing the dragon's breath. And absorption is the ability to mentally and physically induce the energy of the male orgasm into herself. In other words, she wants to pull that energy inside herself and then use that masculine yang energy to both fortify and enhance her own feminine yin energy. They're like two components. If you see the yin-yang sign, right? They're both interdependent, interrelated, feeding each other, working with each other, the masculine, more yang energy, the feminine yin energy, and applying these things together in the correct way can multiply and expand them to make what the white tigress wants to have happen, happen. So now we're getting into the weeds just a little bit, but I'm just going to say a little more and then I'm going to stop. And that is the goal of the practices is to receive for the white tigress a mind illumination of spiritual energy. That is described in the book as seeing many lights with your eyes closed, seeing lights like lanterns gently swaying in your mind when that happens. And they say it's not that easy to have that happen. And you're supposed to go for that 9 times. And after you that's happened 9 times, hopefully within 3 years of practice, you're able to manifest the spiritual fetus. The spiritual fetus is the transformational power that's going to allow you to rebirth yourself. As and they compare it to coming out of a cocoon or going into a cocoon to become that spiritual butterfly. You're in and have that manifest physically in your life. I know this sounds a little bit complex and we will dive into it going forward. Yeah, the spiritual self-pregnancy is what they call it. As if you can make yourself pregnant with the next version of yourself and then bear that into the world. And that's the goal of the White Tigress practices. And then each year, each of the 3 periods is called restoration. So restoring yourself, getting rid of the signs of aging for the first 3 years, preservation, to use these abilities to stay at the level that you want, and then refinement over the next 3 years. And that's what the entire White Tigress manual spoke about. The book that we're looking at now only contains the first 3 years materials, but that is enough to keep you busy for a long time, as you will find out. Okay, this has been Ryan Orok, an introduction to White Tigress Taoism, based upon the book Teachings of the White Tigress from Xi Lai. And if you have any more questions, let me know. And if you whatever page you found this on, there should be a link connecting you to a group or an email list where you can get more information, ask more questions, and meet with others who are learning about these topics. So I appreciate your listening and participating. I hope it was helpful and expanded your mind and your understanding of what your body can do and what you can accomplish through sexual energy. And I look forward to our next conversation.